Mr. Malcolm Muggeridge is unique in important respects and also in unimportant respects. As, for instance, the only person of memory serves to have appeared three times on this program. His background is very well known as a journalist, critic, biographer, and interviewer. Most recently, he has engaged in the writing of his memoirs, which he falsely entitles Chronicles of Wasted Time. The first two books have appeared, The Green Stick and The Infernal Grove, and a third will follow in due course. Meanwhile, this fall, he will bring out a book, Jesus, the Man Who Lives. Mr. Bernard Levin, columnist for The Times, reviewed the volumes in The Observer and wrote, "What a piece of work is Mr. Muggeridge, his indifference to success in this world and his impatience to be done with this muddy vesture of decay are altogether fine and moving. How can this be the same man as the harsh Savonarola of television, calling others to righteousness in the name of the man or God who insisted that only those without sin could cast the stones? In that paradox lies the heart of St. Mugg's mystery." And there was the editorial in the Sunday Times that said quite simply that Mr. Muggeridge's Chronicles of His Wasted Times are, quote, one of the greatest autobiographies of our time. I propose that we begin with a little commentary on very recent events in Great Britain and then meander over into a little cosmic huddle before inviting the panel to interrupt our reveries. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Muggeridge whether the defeat of Edward Heath is in any respect a sign of British health.
I don't think it's in itself a sign of health or sickness, really. It's a sign of the majestic power of this loathsome medium that we're now making use of.
Mrs. Thatcher's good on TV?
Very good, and he's absolutely hopeless. She has a sort of imbecile charm. And poor old Heath, he just has a kind of incoherent honesty.
Does that mean that Harold Wilson has more imbecile charm than Mrs. Thatcher?
No, I wouldn't have said he got more imbecile charm. I wouldn't have said even that charm was his strong suit, but he's got an ostensible quick-wittedness, mm-hmm. which helps him.
Why do you say ostensible?
Well, because it's illusory. Mm-hmm.
He's not, yes. It sinks on examination?
Yes, utterly. Uh-huh. If anybody read his memoirs, it would be impossible for them to think that he was quick-witted, because it is probably the most boring book ever written. But it was so boring that it had a large sale, because I think you've either got to make a book interesting, which produces a certain sale, or to make it so boring that no one can read it, like Eisenhower's memoirs, for instance. In which case,
Lady Bird.
At Lady Bird, yeah. And they want it on their shelves.
Why?
Well, just because it's unread, but majestic, big.
I see. In other words, if it's impenetrable, there's right. no temptation to read it.
It's like The Cloud of Unknowing. I'm sure you know that great mystical classic.
No.
Well, there's between God and us, there's a cloud of unknowing. And it's this that keeps our interest in God alive. If the cloud were removed, it might be more difficult. And so, with certain types of memoirs, you have to have this cloud of unknowing. And it is extraordinary. I think you could say that some of the most tedious books ever written have had very large sales on that basis, including, I would say, Churchill's memoirs, because I don't think that people really read them. This particular sort of rhetoric, after a little while.
Ploys.
Yes, and it becomes very unreal, but they somehow accept it as a great document and put it on their shelves. Publishers make more money, I think, out of unread books than read books. I know you're shortly publishing a book here, and I would like to think that it would be in the red category with a decent following.
Well, I hope so too.
Yes. It's a very good book.
Thank you. The defeat then of Mr. Heath has, so far as you can see, no intrinsic importance, nor is
well,
it suggestive of any reorientation.
I wouldn't quite say that, but I think it is. I think what's going on is an outward and visible sign of the inward and invisible decomposition of a class, really. In other words, that England has been governed, at least that when the Tories have been in power, it meant that a particular class was ruling the country. And I mean, as things go, they weren't too bad. I think they were better than Mr. Scanlon and company, who are really now, if you had to choose between them, But this class has decomposed. It's gone. It's on the run.
Why?
Well, because the historical circumstances, the loss of the empire, the whole moral decomposition of our country and therefore of all forms of order, and indeed of which can be considered in some ways a good thing, the showing up of the pretensions of privileged people, perhaps again partly due to these media, to the fact that people are seen now.
So that they're no longer sort of august.
Right, right. I mean, I often wonder, people like to think that figures like Gladstone and Disraeli were majestic figures and the rulers of our time have been unmajestic, but I wonder how, for instance, those two would have fared in the studios. Mm-hmm. Disraeli might have done...
I think rather well.
Rather well, except that he would have had the disadvantage of the latent anti-Semitism that lies in this country, then particularly. Mm-hmm. And his appearance was very Jewish, wasn't it?
Very Semitic.
Very Semitic.
Yeah. Well, the intrusion of television, you say, punctured the mystique,
yes,
of a ruling class.
Helped,
but it coincided with the fact that the ruling class didn't have quite enough to rule over to justify its top heaviness.
And it also lost its nerve. Mm-hmm. Lost its nerve. I think
what do second sons do now that they don't go out to the
empire? Well, they mostly take to smoking pot. Or appearing on television, or making journeys in motor cars to Nepal and things like that. You see them littered about Europe, bearded, rather sad, and someone whispers to you, he's really the Honourable so-and-so, you know, otherwise indistinguishable from the other people sitting on the Spanish steps in Rome.
That's so much for the second time.
No, but it is, I think that it's one of the keys to the situation here, is this fact that the class has disintegrated, lost its nerve. I mean, you can see it, of course, in journalism. I mean, the Times, the old Times, was the organ of that class. And it's disappeared into the new Times, largely because their class isn't there. To some extent, it was my problem when I was editing Punch.
You mean that there wasn't enough to ridicule?
No, there's masses to ridicule, no shortage there at all, and the upper classes provided a very valuable
In that sense, they continue to be philanthropic.
Yes, they were very lavish with their absurdity. But the point was that they weren't available as a coherent body. Nearly all their sons, like young Galbraith, have moved away from the parental position.
Well, in his case, that would be welcome, right?
You would think so, yes. He wrote such a good review of my book that I've forgiven him everything.
Well, in other words, Colonel Blimp then has really disappeared.
He's disappeared, except he only lives on in the shafts of wit of the left. I mean, that's his only existence.
They have to sort of force feed the establishment,
right,
to
and keep it alive in their little plays and things.
Yeah,
they have
so that they can look back in anger.
Right. How can they look back in anger if Colonel Blimp isn't there?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I noticed recently there was an episode that greatly angered the editor of the Sunday Telegram, Mr. Wursthorn. He was apparently there at some prize-giving ceremony, and the person who received the prize refused to toast the Queen just to begin with.
Yes.
And then gave one of the ritual diatribes against some recent
privilege.
English evil,
yes,
or something.
Yes.
And he walked out, but apparently he was the only one who did.
Yes. Everyone
else sort of smiled.
Took it on the chin, absolutely. Yeah. See, if you take the character of Heath, Heath was put in as leader of the Conservative Party as an alternative to Sir Alec Douglas Hume, who was the last residuum of upper-class Toryism. The last rinsing of the barrel, mm-hmm, was poor Sir Alec. And he was pushed out. And Heath went in as a deliberate gesture to have someone, a sort of scholarship boy, mm-hmm, try that. And the two choices available to them in that field were Powell and Heath. Mm-hmm. Well, they turned Poole down because he frightened them a bit. But he seemed like a good bet. And he was a good bet. I think he's a good man. But he is unfortunately not a glib man, a queer sort of angular man. And since it is really, I think you would agree, in America too, 90% of the business of being in authority to be able to communicate on the media.
You have to be just as folksy.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And he just can't do that. A friend of mine produced him in television for one of those things, and you had to take take after take after take to get the poor old boy across at all. And I think that's to his credit. Just like you might think it was creditable to a woman that she maintained her virginity. You might think it was creditable. I think
but
it's
statistically
creditable.
Statistically,
it's unrewarding.
he was on this program a couple of months ago, Mr. Powell.
Yes.
And I mean, Mr. Heath, and he, I found him perfectly glib, facile.
Absolutely.
But he did have a rather marked reluctance, which perhaps he exhibited only in the United States and wouldn't hear, to particularize any of his complaints. So that every time he roared against something, he roared against a formulation so generic that it was terribly hard to know who it was that he was sore at.
Yes.
Now, he had pre-warned me that it would be in bad taste to criticize any Englishman by name on
any
foreign soil.
Really?
Yeah. So, I didn't know. I didn't know whether that was a sharp departure from his local style. I figured it wasn't.
Well, I think he's a very honorable man, and this is not an age for honorable men in politics. I mean, I think that is probably true. In a way, he's a tragic figure. Because, in terms of ability, I don't feel that he's any particularly, I don't think he's particularly deficient by comparison with the others. And it is very ironical, but of course, history is an ironical thing, that this rather pretty and typical suburban housewife should be the person who displaces him. If she does, but then she did displace him in that particular thing.
But isn't that a little snobbish?
On my part, you mean?
Yeah.
No.
I mean, the fact that she's suburban, one can't utter that word without a hint of condescension.
It's her greatest strength. It's her greatest strength.
Suppose she'd been a metropolitan housewife.
She wouldn't be there.
Oh yeah.
No. It is that particular flavour of the supermarket that's got her. That's got her there. I'm sure it is. And, I mean, who knows, that may be, in a sense, from a public relations point of view, correct. But I just feel that there should be a contest between her and Heath, who was also chosen in the hope that he would satisfy the sort of people who are satisfied by Mrs. Thatcher, and he signally hasn't.
Well, is there anything that Mrs. Thatcher has said that is appealing, or is it just she who is appealing?
I think it's awfully difficult. Wouldn't you agree, you're a close observer of public affairs, that it's people's appeal is perhaps 80% symbolic and only 20%...
substantive.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't you agree?
And I mean,
hers is 80%.
Where would her 20% come in?
Well, I mean, she would come in that she was a perfectly creditable Minister of Education, that she could articulate relatively clearly. And she has a husband who is a perfectly creditable person, and a son with just the right length of long hair.
That sounds like
not too long.
Not 20%.
Yes, it does. I haven't built it up very successfully.
Well, is she a trenchant critic of the superstitions of socialism or not?
No, not really. I wouldn't have said that. I think she would say we all ought to be nice and friendly together. And of course, I don't believe in it, but I quite see that you're entitled to. I don't think she's moved into that area of being a trenchant critic. But
in
I think
sense of Powell, for instance.
Exactly.
Is.
Oh, yeah. Well, he's a very trenchant critic.
Is he considered to be through in England?
I think he is, yes, but I don't. It's difficult to know for certain. I think that he could now be, I mean, he could, if he'd played his hand differently, he could have simply swept in automatically. Almost as the alternative to Heath. But he's been frustrated by his personal hatred of Heath. and also by a sort of crazy honesty in him. He's a bit too mad for politics, except in Hitlerian terms.
Yeah, I mean, maybe we should soften that. Well, you mean fanatical?
Yes, but I do mean mad, really, and I mean it as a compliment. Actually, but I mean that he is farouche. He really has very wild opinions. And again, with universal suffrage and the media dominating the scene, this won't do, except in very exceptional circumstances.
It won't do for the leader?
No.
Yeah.
And it doesn't even cut a swathe in the routine of politics.
Yeah.
I once thought to myself that, and I don't think it's really invalidated now, that in British politics, if you are to excel, you must conform either you must seem like a clergyman or like a bookie. I mean, those are the two great types.
But no mélange de genre.
No.
One or the
other. And a great many politicians are like clergymen or nonconformist ministers.
And above all, moralists.
Moralists,
yeah.
Very much so.
And the bookies are the Harold Wilson types.
Wilson and Churchill. Churchill with his cigar and his gestures, he was an absolute perfect image of a very high-grade bookie. big turnover.
The notion is very popular in America, and you probably spotted it, that it was good for Great Britain that Harold Wilson should have beaten Heath for the reason that Heath could not have dealt with a mutinous situation which would not have got less mutinous as a result of a change in democratic mandate. These people then go on to argue that Powell's withdrawal from the Conservative Party was really providential, in that had he not withdrawn, Heath would have won, and Heath would, under the circumstances, have presided over a country willing to challenge the authority of a democratic mandate. Is that sound reasoning?
I think there's a theme of sense in it, yes. But of course, it leaves out of account really what is the most important aspect of that, which is that Wilson got in truly because people considered that he was able to appease the unions. Mm-hmm. In other words, that he would buy them off.
That's right. Yeah.
And that Heath wouldn't buy them off.
Yeah.
He got in exactly the same, for the exactly the same reasons that Neville Chamberlain did.
Yeah.
Neville Chamberlain was the darling of the English electorate, whatever they may say now, I'm old enough to remember, because he was prepared to appease Hitler and stop a war. They didn't want a war. The English, at the last election.
It's a good thing not to want.
Certainly. I know no criticism of that. But I mean, they considered that Chamberlain could appease Hitler to the point of averting a war. And then, of course, when he didn't avert it, they turned and rent him. Now, I think, in a sense, in the domestic scene, you could compare Wilson's position to Chamberlain's. And if he succeeds in appeasing the unions, without completely without destroying the country, which would be the equivalent of actually having a war, then I think he will go down to history as having performed a useful task. It's quite true that if Heath had been re-elected, there would have had to be some kind of a showdown. Just as if Churchill had been elected Prime Minister instead of Chamberlain, there would have been a showdown with the Nazis 2 years
earlier,
before it came. And therefore, this is a matter in which anybody can make up his or her mind. But that is the truth of it.
Well, does it appear to you that in the period since the election, reality has crept in to the consciousness of the labor union leadership sufficiently to cause it to moderate its demands and to make it possible for England
to
resurface?
Yes. I don't think there's any evidence of that. I certainly think if you would get inside the consciousness of people like Mr. Gormley and so on, you would find they were very uneasy about it. But they're not.
The bluster continues.
Well, it has to, because each of them has got pressing on his heels someone who will make bigger demands.
Yeah. Mr. Heath made the point on this program that a significant disadvantage to nationalization that had not in fact been ventilated at the time was that when a labor union pushes against a private company for extra pay, it has starkly visible before it the limited resources of the employer. But this is never the case where you are dealing with the government. This, said he, is one reason why the demands of the nationalized industries tend to be especially egregious. Mm. Now,
I think he's right.
You think that's right?
Yes.
The notion that, after all, the entire resources of the United Kingdom are potentially or theoretically available.
Absolutely.
To the coal workers or to the postal workers.
When I was a young socialist, one of our favorite arguments was, we said that if you nationalize industries, there will be no strikes, because men will never strike against themselves.
Did they really believe that?
Oh, yes, absolutely. But of course, what they left out of account was that the if you nationalize the railways, they didn't thereby become consciously the owners of the railways. They were still employees. As you say, they were employees in an organization which had unlimited cash at its disposal. And Heath is quite right. The demands in the nationalized industries have been much severer, with the possible exception of the motor business, where they have Americans, and Americans seem to have unlimited cash as well. It's an old-fashioned, out-of-date view, but there is a general feeling that Ford can go on producing money.
There's a remote treasury somewhere.
Yes, and he's a rich man and so on.
Yeah. Well, is there, in fact, as a result of England's experience with socialism or a moderated socialism, is there, in fact, a considerable revision in the attitude of English intellectuals toward it as a doctrine, having come up against such failures as you describe?
Well, God forbid that I should speak for English intellectuals.
No, but simply...
No, I skip...
I'm asking you not to speak for them.
No,
but transcribe.
But to transcribe. Yeah. It's not an easy question, but of course what they, as far as it would seem to me, have done is simply, as their disillusionment with the kind of Fabian socialism which we've had in this country grows, they simply move their position to a more and more extreme leftist position. In fact, so that they become Maoists, or they become communists, or they become Che Guevaraists, or something like that. They certainly, I think that the number of relatively youthful intellectuals who, with their hands on their hearts, would say that a new Jerusalem was being built by Harold Wilson and Mr. Callaghan and Mrs. Barbara Castle will be few and far between. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's
but that's what we
reassuring.
Used to say, you see, because they hadn't been in. We didn't know what they were going to do. Then we had Ramsay MacDonald, and then we knew.
To jump rather abruptly, apropos your reference to this continual utopianization of politics, Irving Kristol wrote a year or so ago that the single most important political datum of the 19th century, political datum, was the collapse of Christian faith. On the grounds that all of the eschatological ambitions of Christianity were simply taken by politics, by ideology. Now, would you say that this would be true in England? Do people actually look to the Labour Party as the agent of of utopia, thinking that it will bring them the kind of spiritual serenity that they don't seem to be able to find in the Church of England?
Well, I agree with it to this extent, that, and I agree with him certainly in the enormous importance of this, that through the socialist movement, you have had the notion of a kingdom of heaven on earth, which has seemed to fill the bill of the kingdom of heaven in the New Testament. And I don't mean by that merely heaven in the sense of the place we go to, but Christ's kingdom. This kingdom that he came to proclaim, and that has filled that bill. The odd thing about it is, and again, from my point of view, a touch of irony, that the final legatees of that, as I consider, utterly fallacious view are the Anglican clergy. You find them absolutely neither to hold nor to bind in insisting that everything that that the New Testament is about can be fulfilled through the Labour Party, and that if Jesus was not a paid-up member of the Labour Party, it was merely because there was no Labour Party, unfortunately, in Galilee at that time. Had there been one, he would have joined immediately.
He'd been an organizer.
And have become a life peer.
Well, the this is the result of agonized search for recognition. Is it the notion of the clergy you speak of, that they won't otherwise be noticed unless they come out
but
the free ping-pong?
But they won't otherwise have anything to say, because for the most part they've lost their faith. I mean, the faith in Christianity as a transcendental view of life has diminished enormously in all, I would have said, including your church, the Roman Catholic Church, to an enormous degree. Therefore, they've either got to go out of business altogether or look round and see some earthly equivalent of that, something they can hold up.
Consubstantiation.
Right, very much so. And that has been the story of institutional Christianity. And I think that Irving Christie is absolutely right in saying that that change is really the most, it's much more important, in my view, than, for instance, Marxism, or than the Russian Revolution, or the Chinese Revolution. This is the total collapse of transcendental Christianity. But what is even more fascinating is, where do you find this transcendental Christianity raising its head again? You find it in the communist countries, among the dissidents, of whom, obviously, Solzhenitsyn is a classic example. And why is it there? Because to a dissident in the Soviet Union, any idea of expressing his dissidence through such ludicrous propositions as universal suffrage, democracy, or the United Nations Bill of Rights.
Just to trivialize his whole
trivialize the whole thing. And he sees that there's no other answer to absolute power than transcendentalism.
And a redemptive answer.
A very redemptive answer. Yeah. And so Solzhenitsyn, in that extraordinary, I think one of the most extraordinary things he wrote, that letter that he addressed to the Soviet government shortly before he left the country, he says that. He says, I'm not against the Soviet regime as such. I'm not against dictatorial government. I don't think that by dismantling a dictatorial government, you will automatically achieve freedom. What I'm against is the ideology, is Marxism, which gives the notion that men can satisfy their aspirations in worldly terms. That is the great fallacy, that is the great illness. And the only answer to that is Christ. Now, it's extraordinary that this should come from that side and be, in a sense, shouted down by the, at any rate, the trendy clerics of all denominations on our side.
Well, as a matter of fact, it was probably the first document of Solzhenitsyn that brought overt sneers in the West.
Certainly, because he's not playing the game as they expect it to be played. He ought to say, we must reinstitute democracy. We must revive the Narodniki and the parties. We must have an election. He said, that's all rot. That is absolutely nothing.
Well, I don't think he said so much that it was all rot.
He simply said
that it would not necessarily bring about those satisfactions that Russia most pined for, and that a very good case could be made for saying that it was simply not now feasible.
Yes.
And this, of course, he was rejected by Sakharov.
Right.
But Sakharov signed the Humanist Manifesto, so he doesn't know what...
he doesn't know what anything about. Is, no. The thing is that... anyway, I seem to detect, which was to me very sympathetic, and maybe that's why I detected it, a certain distaste for the nauseous platitudes of
liberal democracy,
which becomes more and more threadbare as they support the installation in power of black demagogue dictators on the grounds of this. Liberal. I mean, that to Solzhenitsyn is an utterly ridiculous spectacle.
Is it your notion that the faith that is growing out of this particular womb, annealed by this particular experience, is something that can prove contagious, or is this is the cynicism of the West too impacted share it without experiencing the same ordeal?
It's very difficult to answer that, but as I take the view myself that the West is in a state of dissolution and will, within a relatively short time, fall to pieces. What's called Western civilization will finally fall to pieces in a relatively short time. I would say that that will be the most important force in the world, and it's one that I feel so intensely in sympathy with. And I notice this among my own fellow countrymen, because whereas I've been saying things like this, as you know, for a long time, and whereas they would regard me as either an obvious case of senility or otherwise a debilitated person, who'd written too many words and grown too old to be capable of any coherent thought anymore, I find now, to some extent, a different attitude, a realization that in face of this total collapse, not merely of the material structure, because that is not very important, really. I mean, that can be replaced, that can be dealt with. But of all the assumptions, particularly, for instance, education, that if you spend more and more money on education, you will produce more and more enlightened people. And these enlightened people will create an enlightened brotherly society.
That would sound like Erasmus.
All you, absolutely, and be reading A Paradise Lost to each other instead of the News of the World and so on. Actually, of course, exactly the opposite's happened. It's enormously increased illiteracy here.
Gresham's Law.
Yes, the more money. I like to think that the final moment when politicians will go on spending more money on education because they think it's a surefire sign of enlightenment. They're always trying to appear enlightened. And this is, you vote another so many millions to education, and that shows you're an enlightened man. Mm-hmm. And I like to think that when they have got into the position of spending practically the whole revenue of the country on education, we shall be almost entirely a nation of illiterates, except for a few old men who will still be mooning about in the London Library.
Reading Stephen's
paper. Yes, that's right.
Mr. Peter Riddell is with the Financial Times. Mr. Riddell.
Mr. Muggeridge, I find interesting your idea that, which you agree with Mr. Buckley on, that the single most important fact over the last century is the breakdown of belief in religious faith. How has this occurred? I mean, I'm interested in the historical process you're talking about, because when was the faith upheld? How many people upheld it?
Yes, I don't think you can measure it in that sort of way. You see, in the sense in which I'm trying, I'm not saying that, say, in the 18th century there were hordes of believing, dedicated Christians, and now there aren't. What I'm saying is that in the 18th century, and up to perhaps, if you want a date, we'll say, to the Darwin.
1839.
Yes, if you like. I mean, it's a date. Obviously, before that, there were plenty of things moving that. But you could say the acceptance of science as the ultimate revelation of truth, the explanation of our existence on Earth. I would have said that was, and it isn't that, as I say, that before that, there were hordes of marvelous Christians, and after that, none. But it was that the notion that our destiny in this world was only capable of transcendental expression was abandoned, and you had this notion, which is produced in its final vulgarity in poor old Bronowski's, late lamented Bronowski's television series called The Ascent of Man. I mean, there, if you want it.
This is when science triumphed.
Yes. It's an interesting thing that you could, I think, if any sociologist 1,000 years from now is interested enough to do it, or several hundred years, he could find in those three popular series, Clark's Civilization, which leaves out of account completely the Christian religion and, Bronowski's Ascent of Man, and, if you like, Alistair Cook's America, you could find, in the really sort of popular sense, the gospel mm-hmm. of materialism of our time.
There's no problems with translation, of course, but...
None whatever.
You got the triumph of science then.
Yes.
Are you sufficient of a pessimist to believe the ultimate triumph of science is our self-destruction?
Well, I don't... that is possible. I mean, I just don't know about that. In a sense, I'd like to think it was, because it would complete the story very, very beautifully. But I wouldn't be insistent upon that. But I think that what has happened is that in that process, mm-hmm. The traditional faith and the values that went therewith, which in a very inadequate, clumsy way were passed on from generation to generation, and which in a very inadequate, clumsy way governed people's attitude to life, has utterly disappeared. And if you wanted to complete the thing, I mean, to bring in the Victorian age, was really what makes it such a peculiar thing, is that it was the period, the intermediate period, when people were running on the sort of momentum of a faith they'd lost. Now that momentum is spent.
It's gone, yeah.
It's gone.
Yeah.
We're still...
It's not only gone. Do you know Wyndham Lewis's short story on the Bishop's Fool?
No.
Well, it's very much in point. This is the Anglican priest who is slowly begins to starve because of a lack of patronage of his own church. So he wanders around and gets more and more sort of dilapidated. But it seems to me significant that at least in a place like Leningrad, you have a museum devoted to religion and atheism, the purpose of which is to keep on persuading people that religion was always the opiate of the masses and so on and so forth. Here, that doesn't any longer seem necessary, so that Lord Clark's series feel that that is not even intellectually necessary to confront.
Right, and he wouldn't blush aspect. In any way for it, you know,
yeah.
because it's not an important any longer, an important factor. But what is interesting is that the only place it is an important factor is among the dissidents in the communist regimes, where, of course, in Poland, very much in terms of an enormously powerful church, but also everywhere. Throughout these countries, only because, as with the early Christians, it provides the only alternative, the only serious alternative to the total subordination by power. You don't agree with
that? Yes, no, I do, but it is not, I don't think that, in our time, people acknowledge that dichotomy.
No, but they're beginning to. It's very curious. They are beginning to. Even clergymen begin to see there might be something in it.
In their religion.
Yes. It's very difficult for them to go as far as that. But they do, if you push them along, there comes a point when they will admit that it has something to offer, even though the whole idea of the kingdom of heaven on earth
achieved... It's so much more appealing. Yeah.
Yes, yeah. But it's looking very frayed around the edges, you see.
Miss Patricia Hewitt is with the Civil Liberties Association, Miss Hewitt.
Yes, I find it ironic that when you were talking about English politics, you were so clearly nostalgic for some form of Tory, upper class, rather ill-defined.
Dear, you wrong me. No? I promise you,
Honour?
No. I just think that's history, that's
gone. As a matter of fact, didn't he say that he was rather pleased that one of the things that collapsed along with some of the other things?
I don't think you can't accuse me of that. I'm no nostalgia for it. I just recognize that it was something that was there, and now it's not there.
It was palpable, and now it's not.
Right, and now it's gone.
Well, possibly, but it did seem to me all the same that a nostalgia came through.
Well, I would hate to ask anybody to look through the bound volumes of Punch and I's editor, but I feel that that would be my alibi.
Well, no, it may be that you missed that particular role. All right, well, picking you up on another point, when you were saying, I think rightly, that the view that you can go on spending more on education is going to produce a more enlightened society, but what else would you have the politicians do? Taking education as
a case in point. You see, it's really, I don't think the politicians can do anything about this. Mm-hmm. That, I mean, if what I say is correct, that the heart of our civilization mm-hmm. was lost when when the Christian religion was lost. And that is a very large generalization which would require a lot of qualification. There's nothing politicians can do about that. And it's rather nice that they can't.
But they can be less pretentious, can't they?
They can be less pretentious. But I mean, if you imagine St. Paul writing to the Christians in Corinth, that was in the time of the Emperor Nero. Well, I think even Mr. Nixon would seem relatively enlightened by comparison with the Emperor Nero. But St. Paul didn't waste any time on him, because it never so much as occurred to him that he or his minions had anything to say about what he was talking about. I think we've got back to that point. And that even, I mean, in a way, as a Christian or an aspiring Christian, the people I feel most scared of are people who propose to have a Christian political party.
Yes, I can understand that.
You see,
but do you find, if you take the sort of aim which is common on the left, to redistribute wealth, to redistribute access to power, do you find that distasteful, dangerous, or simply irrelevant?
I find it irrelevant, completely irrelevant, because this has been undertaken during my 50 sad years as
very
a journalist. It's been attempted in numerous ways, not only with no success, but almost invariably producing the exact opposite. I mean, the Russian Revolution occurred in order to to create a brotherly society. Produced Stalin. 20 million people knocked off one way or another by that good man. And wherever you look, in where it has been attempted through power to create perfect human conditions, perfect relationships between man and man, it's always produced the opposite. And I reached the conclusion myself that when Jesus declined the offer of the devil for the kingdoms of the earth, he was a very sagacious decision, because if he'd been one of these trendy clergymen or Father Berrigan or someone like that, he'd have taken it with both hands and set about creating a brotherly republic.
I think he'd had difficulty on the William Buckley show when he was subsequently interviewed.
Yes, well, I think that is so, and that's one of the great utilities
of the show.
He could
have made me disappear in a puff of smoke.
But you see my point.
I don't think
power is a factor in this thing. And that
well,
is
power is clearly a factor in the redistribution of wealth. I would challenge your view that anyone who is interested in the redistribution of wealth necessarily believes that that is going to create a perfect society. I would agree with your views, I think, on the limitations of politics, but that's not to say that I consider politics irrelevant.
No, well, fair enough, and I would go with you and say that I think that, for instance, taxation in this country, which has enormously redistributed wealth, is on the whole a good thing.
But of course it hasn't enormously redistributed wealth.
Well, it has much more than is commonly admitted, but it is true that that a great deal of wealth has been ploughed back.
I think it's done a great deal to impoverish this country.
It has, in a way, too.
Mr. Shimon Peres, who's a socialist, said on this program a year or so ago in Israel, he said, on the whole, I would have to agree with you that those who put freedom above equality have done better by equality than those who have put equality first.
Yes, well, I take that, absolutely. But anyway, what I mean is that I personally, that any coherent, reasonable proposal for taking from people who have too much to help those who have too little has my support. But it's not as easy as it sounds, as Bill has been saying, and that's another thing that we've learnt in some bitterness in the years of the last decades. In some bitterness. I mean, inequality in the USSR, we were filming there last year, and it was rather funny, really, because the Soviet television place is exactly like the BBC. It's most extraordinary. You can't tell you're not in it, even to the point that the brass are on the fifth floor. You get onto this fifth floor, and suddenly the secretaries are pretty. You know, everything is jolly, and you realize that you're in the world of it. But it's exactly the same. And so we can't really say that.
Hot and cold running perquisites.
Absolutely.
Mr. James Galbraith is a graduate student at Cambridge. Mr. Galbraith?
Yes, Mr. Muggeridge, I'd like to say that I read with delight your description of the tedium that used to settle in on you as an undergraduate every time the train pulled into Cambridge. I feel exactly the same way.
Well, I'm delighted to hear you say it.
Let me ask you, I find it interesting your position that it is socialism that has a monopoly on holding out the promise of paradise on earth, kingdom of heaven on earth, to modern man. It seems to me that if you look at capitalist ideology from Adam Smith through Jeremy Bentham onward,
capitalist doesn't have ideology.
You get exactly the same, Mr. Buckley notwithstanding, you get exactly the same promise, an optimal allocation and efficient use of the resources in a society.
Well, I certainly agree with you that capitalism has responded to this complete change that science has brought about in human values in its own way, and it has offered through through affluence, through Keynesian economics and so on, the through installment buying and all the rest of it, the things that the communists offer in their various manifestos. And as a matter of fact, the communists from the beginning, when they took power in Russia, have looked with particular admiration at these successes in this field in America. And that is, in a way, the dream, their dream.
But do you feel this promise to be equally irrelevant?
I consider it to be even more disastrous.
Well, in the first place, if I may intervene as maybe the only capitalist in the room, at least believer in capitalism, I don't see any of this in the relevant documents of capitalism. The claims of capitalism are simply that people will prosper materially by being permitted to proceed in the private sector rather than in the public sector. But I don't know if anybody, short of cuckoo land, Ayn Rand types, who say that it's going to bring a eudaimonia, a society dominated by reason, right, in which everyone is happy or anything.
But so wouldn't you say that Roosevelt, Roosevelt's response to the Depression was to produce...
You mean the 14 freedom stuff?
His economic plans, his enormous business of pump priming and all this stuff, that this was, in fact, offering people the kingdom of heaven on earth.
No, I don't think so. I think Mr. Galbraith is talking about theoretical presumptions of capitalism.
Well, I know little about
that. And I say that there is no capitalist... certainly not The Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith, certainly not anything written by Ricardo or John Stuart Mill.
I would remind you of the work of one of your own professors, Economics of Welfare by Professor Pigou, which runs very much along those lines.
He didn't say, certainly didn't talk about, paradise on earth.
Oh, no. Oh, he offers it. He talks about Pareto optimality and the optimal and efficient distribution of resources.
Sure.
Which is close, like code words.
No, but this is a purely technical observation.
But no,
it has nothing. I mean, it's like taking the communion host and putting it under a microscope and asking whether or not you find particles of divinity in it. Pigou is a technician, but he is not a theorist of utopia on earth.
No, it has to do with what's normatively the best way and the most efficient way to organize your society.
But that has nothing to do with what Mr. Muggeridge's talking about.
No, but
that's an argument apart.
No,
from,
but
from
is,
an
I think
that
there is this amount of truth in Galbraith's point that capitalism. I mean, I'm talks of capitalism and talks of acquisitive society, such as we've had here until relatively recently. You've still, to some extent, got in America, has offered its the electorate increasingly. 5 acres and a cow or whatever, these particular...
Well, of course, that would be paradise in India, I suppose, at least until they got bored.
But, I mean, it has suggested, and in all its dialogue with the communists across the Iron Curtain through Radio Free Europe and all these things, the argument that capitalism does offer a better material life to people is very much used, and I've always felt this very weak argument that the poor success of the communist countries economically is not a strong argument.
Well, it's not a strong argument at the level at which you are approaching the problem. I agree, but it's an extremely strong argument for somebody who's starving to death.
Yes, if they're starving, then of course there are plenty of people starving to death in so-called capitalist countries too.
Where?
I regret. Well, India.
It is not a capitalist country.
Well, it's not a communist country.
I mean, Professor Galbraith delivered a splendid set of lectures 10 years ago in which he urged India to desocialize its agriculture.
Yes, but I mean, it still is a country of proprietors and privately held. Yeah,
but that's like saying that the British Indians. People own the railroads.
Yes, it is. But I mean, the point is that
if you regulate, if everything that you can do with a piece of tract of land is decided by some central authority in New Delhi by 5,000 bureaucrats,
the answer is yes, we're not own. Case, Mr. Buckley.
Excuse me.
It doesn't happen to be.
It's
the
not
case,
the case, you know, Bill. I hate not to support you, but the fact is,
what isn't the case?
No, that is that it is like that. I mean, if Professor Galbraith said that, he was talking nonsense, with all respect to an ex-ambassador. The point is that India in the villages is you are in the world of peasants. Proprietors. You are in the world of men employed on straight and even ruthless capitalistic lines. It's also true that the Parsis and people who own the great industries there, they are capitalists, most certainly.
Well, they are capitalists subject to taxation, subject to regulation, subject to whom they can hire, subject to what they can afford.
But they don't do badly,
so
you know, still, they don't do badly. I'm not
saying...
You're saying
they're rich people in India, I agree
no,
with you.
No, but I mean, but these people like these Parsis and people who own these great industries, they are also rich people. I don't think, in a way, this is very important, but I would agree with you that in its defensive operation, the capitalist world has fallen into the same kingdom of heaven on earth, pitfall. And you would find that the one man in England who has almost the point of insanity spoken against that, is he not Powell?
Well, but you're talking about the advertisements of Playboy or something. Buy a Chrysler car and you will live a happy forever.
Could I?
But yes. That really isn't capitalist doctrine, is it?
No, could I move on from the crumbling of Western civilization?
By all means.
Yes, I mean, it's going to be very soon, according to Mr. Muggeridge. I mean, we better start reading his last volume soon.
Well, very soon, in the same sense as St. Paul said that the Kiliastic event will be very soon.
I think that Mr. Muggeridge is viewing it on a tighter time scale.
I say that I don't know, but nor did St. Paul. I mean, he actually he supported the prevailing belief that people who were then alive would not all be dead before this apocalypse. I'm not predicting an apocalypse. I'm predicting only one simple historical thing: the collapse of what is called Western civilization, which means the dominance of Western Europe and the United States.
Well, let's lift the death sentence away from us for the moment.
Yes.
But isn't he, your one strand, I'd call it optimism, and perhaps be insulting you, your one strand of hope is the kind of personal mysticism, because that's what you're really saying. Isn't that really a counsel of despair for the vast majority?
No, not at all. Well, then, would you say that for instance, when the Roman Empire collapsed and Saint Augustine held out this hope in words of great eloquence in his sermons, would you say that he was offering them a faint strand of hope? He was offering them what was to prove to be a new great wave of creativity.
And a wave of creativity through institutions.
Yes, so what?
I mean, the institutions are power, aren't they?
Yes, they are. And this has to relate itself to power. I'm not saying that you can do without power. I'm saying that the ultimate truths of life are, at their peril, entwined with power.
So there's a corruption you dance with.
There's a corruption which is part of what is called in the New Testament the mammon of unrighteousness, you may recall, which the founder of the Christian religion said it was very important to keep track of it. He didn't say, he said keep track of it, it's very important. Because the people who are good at the mammon of unrighteousness are the children of darkness, and you are the children of light, and you'll be at a disadvantage if you allow them to take every trick. And that is the moral of the unjust steward, the famous parable of the unjust steward. Sure. So I don't, of course power is there. Men can't live without power, without coming in some degree to terms with it. But I think it was the genius of the Christian religion that it provided a sort of insulation against the ultimate takeover of power.
By the temple order.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much, Mr. Muggeridge, and thank you, Ms. Hewitt, Mr. Riddell, Mr. Galbraith. Thank you all.
printed, bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. That's $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Production funding provided by public television stations, the Ford Foundation, and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.